Wait, hey everybody from EsquinaDelCine.com. We're here once again with Miguel Rodriguez, the programmer from the Un Mundo Extraño showcase, which every year he shows, especially horror movies, fantastic cinema, all that kind of weird stuff that we love. So I wanted to ask you again, what do you brought us this year, and what are we expecting to see on the festival this 2018?
I think for 2018, 25th year, a quarter century of Latino Film Festival, I decided we were going to show some more. So I've got 7 blocks for Un Mundo Extraño, including 1 block of short films. Okay. So 6 features and a block of short films.
It's all Mexico crazy. Raro y Querido? No, which one is yours? It's the Sunday one, right?
The shorts film?
Yeah, yeah.
It's Sunday at 6:30. Oh, yes.
Okay, yeah.
So it's a Un Mundo Extraño shorts film block.
Okay, yeah.
And it's got 6 short films.
Actually, one of them is from a director from Tijuana, right? Alejandra?
Yes, Alejandra. Oh, my God.
Her Microcastle. Microcastle.
Yes, yes.
It's a great,
yes.
great short film.
Great short film. Oh, good. You've already seen it.
Yeah, I saw it. It showed in a couple of festivals down in Tijuana, and that's one of my favorite shorts from last year.
Excellent. Oh, yeah. Well, I picked that one myself, so I'm proud to say. We've got a couple of Frontera filmmakers.
Okay.
Yeah, actually, for that, I was happy to say. And another one from a filmmaker in Los Angeles called The Ningyo.
Okay.
And it's a very strange film. Miguel Ortega directed it with his wife, who is of Japanese descent.
Okay.
But it's kind of like a science fiction Jules Verne, but they filmed it in their house. And they are they're visual effects artists for things like Pirates of the Caribbean and
they have the knowledge to make great.
Oh my God, it's
visually
crazy.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Like, it looks like you just have to go see it.
And regarding the movies, this is the first time, at least in the years I've been coming to the festival, that you have 2 classics movies playing.
Yeah.
Kronos, which plays tonight.
Tonight.
Mm-hmm. And tomorrow is going to Alucarda, which is one of my favorite all-time movies.
I
love that film. So I wanted to ask you how that process came that you got these 2 classic movies, and what were you expecting from the audience?
Well, let's start with Kronos.
Okay, yeah.
So they're both anniversary screenings. I don't know if I should look at you or
the camera, me, whatever.
They're both
The trolley.
The monsters flying by. They're both anniversary screenings, so it was great, actually. This is the 25th year anniversary of Latino Film Festival's 25th anniversary of Kronos, Guillermo del Toro's first film.
Which is very timely, right? Because he just
is on
everybody's mind right now, so it's pretty cool.
And the year that he won, for Best Director.
For the thing he does the best, right? Directing.
Yes, for the thing he does the best, exactly, for The Shape of Water. So it was like everything kind of coalesced. Now, what I didn't realize was that finding the rights to Kronos was going to be a challenge.
Yeah.
We tried all over the place. But it turns out, you know, no Janus, no Criterion. Criterion put out the Blu-ray. Didn't own the theatrical rights, and nobody did. The rights reverted back to one of the original producers.
Okay.
And so I had to contact him and work that out. So that's always been a challenge. It's like detective work.
That's like the challenge behind making festivals, right?
Yes.
Sometimes people, you got the movie, maybe you just bought the Blu-ray on Best
Buy,
and then
you
screen it.
Oh,
but
no,
it's not easy as that.
It's not easy. No.
Of course it's not.
Because you have to find out who if you can't find who owns the rights, you can't legally show it.
And with Alucarda, how did that happen?
Well, the nice thing about Alucarda is the director, Juan López Moctezuma, his daughter lives here in San Diego. Alessandra, and that was restored in a wonderful DVD by one of my favorite labels,
Mondo Macabro. Do they have it in Blu-ray? Because I have the DVD, but I don't know
No, they don't. They still haven't done much with Blu-ray.
Okay.
And Alucarda is one of those. The 35mm does not exist for this film anymore.
Yeah, but I just saw the ending of Kronos, but that's the thing that I want to invite people to see these movies, even though they are classics.
Yes.
But to see them on big screen, remastered in HD. They look so beautiful. I was telling my partner that I cannot believe that a movie that old, like 25 years old, looks so great on Blu-ray or HD or.
It depends on how they're restored.
Yeah,
right? It can go one way or the other.
But Criterion does a really great job.
Criterion,
yeah.
That's legit. Some of the translations are strange.
Yeah,
right? They're not. But it looks amazing. What's interesting about Alucarda is. That was filmed in English.
Yeah, and it's dubbed in Spanish.
In Spanish. So one of the big conversations was how we were going to show it. But at the request of Alessandra, because it was her father's preference, we're actually going to show it in English.
Oh, in English, okay.
Yeah, which I, you know, it ended up making me embarrassed because...
And it's weird because it's not even a Mexican Spanish. It's a Spanish from Spain.
Yeah.
So even to us, it sounds weird because why everybody's... These Mexican actors are talking in Spanish
in
from
European
Spain.
Spanish.
In European Spanish. Yeah,
yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, because it's... You know, it takes place in European, like, Inquisition times. So that actually was smart. It made sense. But it was filmed in English, so it's dubbed anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
In that Spanish. Everybody's speaking English in the film. That's one thing. When I first saw the film, it was on VHS bootleg.
And so everything is going to look better either way.
Yeah,
right?
Well, it looked like it looked horrible. And so I didn't even realize it was dubbed.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I just thought it was a Spanish movie. But when the Mundo Macabro disc came out, then which has actually an interview with Guillermo del Toro on it. Mundo Macabro let us show it. They just said, yeah, do it. They're great people. And so finding the rights for that, super easy. I've worked with them in the past. And then Alessandra, she is going to come talk about the film, talk about her father, and let me know that he preferred the English version, which I didn't know.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the most, for me, it's one of the best Mexican horror movies ever made. Because of its weirdness, the subject matter, everything it does.
It's very brave.
Yeah, because there's another one called Satanico Pandemonium that
is
also with... No, it's really good, but it did it like differently. This movie, I think it's very extreme on the ways it's showing everything.
It's funny. I was telling people before Kronos about the screening tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I mentioned... that, you know, the nunsploitation thing, there was all these movies from all over. But Mexico had the two big ones, which was Alucarda and Satanico Pandemonium. And I mentioned that one, but Alucarda is my favorite. And partly because it's the most brave.
Yeah.
It has the best production design.
Yeah, those weird white mummy nuns. That's an image that nobody ever going to get out of their heads.
And, you know, it doesn't shy away from anything. It shows everything.
Yeah.
And
I think Moctezuma did some of the best horror movies. I mean, I think the two main players are always Enrique Tawada, which made the trilogy. The Viento Tiene Miedo, Book of Stone, all that.
Which you can get as a box set.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other one, I think it was a bit more weirder, but it was Moctezuma. For me, always he did with La Mansión de la Locura.
Which, that
and
is...
Mary, Bloody Mary.
Alessandra's favorite is...
Yeah. La Mansión de la Locura.
Yeah.
Mansion of Madness.
The Mansion of Madness, yeah. The Edgar Allan Poe one.
Yeah, that's really cool. And regarding the newer releases that you have on this event, like Inquilinos and everything. No, Inquilinos, it's weird because it translates like Lodgers, and you recently screened a movie called Lodgers, but it's not the same.
If you look at the poster, too, the
poster is
really
right.
Similar. Yeah, yeah. So,
But I haven't seen that one. I'm really hoping...
The Lodgers is great.
No, I saw The Lodgers, but I didn't see...
You didn't see
Inquilinos. No.
Okay. They're very different films. They're both paranormal films that take place in a big, beautiful house.
Yeah.
So, other than that... other than that, they're, you know, The Lodgers, you saw it already, has some very interesting things about it. Inquilinos is more about the history of this couple coming back to Hollywood.
Yeah.
A great paranormal, creepy film. Some interesting things thrown in that make it less conventional.
Yeah.
Right. We're showing El Vecino, which by Giancarlo Ruiz, who is a local filmmaker. A lot of psychological stuff in his.
That's
film.
A pretty good movie. It's also in the.
You've already seen it.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Okay.
Yeah, I saw it because it's like Giancarlo
because
from San Diego, Tijuana.
Right, Tijuana.
He screened it a couple of times down
of
there. But
I know. Well,
but I know you haven't seen it, but people here haven't seen it.
Yeah,
so
I told him to show it. I did see it already. I'm looking forward to speaking to him. I know that he's been profiled here before, and he had a short film in my programming partner Beth Accomando, her student film festival. Giancarlo showed something for her years ago.
He has a short called Losetas or Disease. I don't know how the translation. That's something he made, like a zombie movie, I think, or something, short film. And he has like Insecto Bug. And
that's the one, I think.
He has a lot of short films. This is the first time I think he makes a feature. Mm-hmm. And it's a really weird one. I think you're
it's a really weird one.
Yeah.
I love the opening shot. With
And I love that it's a very, it's like a simple plot. It's just two neighbors and something happens. But
it's not a film about the story. It's a film about the psychology and the image.
It drags into a bizarre world, right? Visual and bizarre.
It's very much about the image. And also, I mean, that the setting is used really well. So the town, the streets, all of it is a character. And that's one of the things I really like about it.
It's cool because it's filmed, I think it's filmed in Tijuana and some places down there, but it doesn't, he invented like, it's like a sort of an island or something that doesn't exist. So he created like a collage of a place that doesn't exist, but looks like things, at least way down in Tijuana, we kind of know where they are.
And a lot of people in San Diego will recognize it too. But that's what's interesting is it's a fictional setting, but Tijuana is a very photogenic city.
Yeah.
So especially for fantastic film. So that's where he's very smart, is how he can make you feel like you're in this other world, but it's just Tijuana.
What else are you screening in this festival?
So our late night screening on Saturday is a sequel to an anthology film of Mexican directors. Now, we showed the first one at my festival, Horrible Imaginings, back in 2015.
Okay.
And we had a couple of filmmakers there. So I'm really excited to bring the sequel back with 9 different filmmakers from Mexico. It's called Mexico Barbaro 2, and we've got a variety of films. I think there are a couple of women filmmakers, so there are different voices going on in there. And I'm really excited to bring that. It's at 10 p.m., so this is for the late night people who really like the messed up
stuff. Most of the screenings on Mundo Extraño are the midnight or late night.
I always get stuck with that, yeah.
But it's cool for the fans, it's cool.
I feel a little bit better that Kronos was at 8:30, tomorrow Alucard is at 9:30. We've been around in the 9:30 time. That one's at 10, so it's even a little later.
But I think it's a good time slot
I hope so. San Diego's a sleepy city.
Yeah, well, maybe because we stay up all night, we think everybody's the same, but everybody's in bed by 10, 11, right?
Everything's look around, nothing. Nothing's open.
And I mean, just to get to close this interview, what can you tell us about the festival? You mentioned Horrible Imaginings. What things are you have in mind for this year? Anything you can tell us? It's a bit early. So, and also the screenings you're making with Dread Central Presents.
Well, funny that you should mention Dread Central Presents. I've got John Condit just off camera over there, the founder of Dread Central.
Okay.
So, or co-founder. So that's his baby. But he could speak a lot to Dread Central Presents.
Maybe
as well.
I should ask him. But
if he's up to.
If no.
Do you want to talk Dread Central Presents? You don't. He doesn't want to be on camera.
It's okay.
He's beside the seats. He was at South by Southwest. He literally got in from South by Southwest today in time to get to the screening. But I was asked to be ambassador for San Diego screenings for Dread Central Presents. Now, Dread Central, as anyone who likes horror knows, is one of the biggest websites for horror since like 2006, 2007. So it's been well over a decade. And finally, in partnership with Epic Pictures Group, they have decided to select films, independent films, not only for distribution, but to...
For screenings, right?
For screenings. And these aren't just, we're going to put them in the theater and hope people go. These are special events with people chosen in each city where it's happening to be the ambassadors. So they're there to introduce the films, to make it more special, to have giveaways. And what I really like about Dread Central Presents is every film's so different. So we already mentioned The Lodgers.
I wanted to see the one you showed this week or
Terrifier.
Last week. Terrifier. The clown, the look was great.
I
hope
Terrifier
I get to see
it. Great. It's actually showing around the country today.
Okay.
Now, we showed that a week early because of Latino. But everywhere else, it's showing starting today and tomorrow. So if you look, I posted a video of all the responses to it, all the audience responses, and people had a lot of fun with Terrifier. And you know, next month we've got a film called Screamers, and then a film called Imitation Girl. And you know, you got Terrifier, which is the crazy clown slasher movie, with the clown's actually more of a mime, which is cool and even creepy.
Yeah, if you see the image, you're gonna have nightmares just by seeing the poster alone.
It's awesome. Imitation Girl is more like a science fiction. Lodgers is very paranormal.
That was pretty good. I really like The Lodgers. I like that sort of classic, like early 19th century cinema.
Irish film.
I really like that movie.
Yeah, and it's very beautifully shot.
Yeah.
It's a very artfully done film, but it deals with some really, I'm not going to say it, but some taboo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It sort of reminded me a bit of talking about Guillermo del Toro, Crimson Peak.
Yes.
That
yes.
sort of themes.
And the same kind of atmosphere.
Yeah.
Yes, for sure.
Well, you're less budget maybe, but that was so. No, but it's cool.
That's not fair.
I'm not talking bad about that.
It's no, you're
good.
Right.
It's actually, good that with a few resources, you can make something as good or even beautiful sometimes, no?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, that's one of the beautiful things about the technology we have today
is
it allows different filmmakers. We've got
a helicopter.
They're looking for
they're coming
us.
For us.
Yeah. Allows different filmmakers with these grand visions to actually execute them without, you know, having to spend gajillions of dollars on 35 millimeter and things like that. Sorry for the purists out there, but hey, there you go.
You can be both. I think we don't have to be extremists. We can love the pure, the 35 millimeter, 70 millimeter, but also you can enjoy beautiful HD remasters of movies.
It's
I think
about how it's used.
Yeah.
How the story is told. That's the most important thing.
And lastly, is there anything? I mean, I think it's a bit early, but
for Horrible Imaginings.
Yeah, something you could. I read that
the
you
big
changed.
Thing is removing.
You moved venues. So
yeah, not just venues, but towns.
Okay.
We're not in Los Angeles. We're in
like
Northern
in the middle, right? Like
right in the middle. Yeah. we're in Santa Ana.
Yeah.
Just south of Disneyland.
Yeah.
And it's a great cinema. It's called the Frida Cinema, and it's two screens. And you know, one thing that's nice is if you came to Horrible Imaginings, you know, there's no food. No, it was really hard to do it at the museum. Now we'll have food and drinks in the theater, and popcorn, and restaurants, and I'm just very excited because the Frida is a nonprofit cinema. They get our mission statement, and they want us there. And it's just it's nice to know that we have a real solid partnership in the future with movie lovers who struggle as we do to bring cinema to the people.
I always hear that the festival they always how hard is the work that the festival programmers do, and it's every change is always it might be weird in the beginning, especially with the fans, with the original fans, but there's going to be a new other people that are going to embrace it. Let's hope. So I think
you know, it's bittersweet because I didn't want to leave our fans here. And I know that some of the fans will make the trip.
Yeah.
But it is hard. But I think, you know, you're right. You, one thing we have to do is do what's best for the mission statement, for the filmmakers, and for the organization as a whole. And everything about the cinema and what is being offered in that area is just going to make this even bigger and better than before, and our plans are going to reflect that, and and what we're going to offer our filmmakers is going to reflect that too. So try to come even for a day if you're in San Diego. It's not that far.
It's not that far of a trip. People go to Los Angeles or Disneyland.
If you go to Disneyland,
what's a couple
it's
of miles
closer than
closer,
Disneyland.
Right?
Come on.
So Miguel, thank you very much for this. I thought it was going to be a brief interview, but it got a little bit long.
Oh no, you talk to me. I'm going to talk and talk and talk.
Okay, so thank you very much. And
thank you.
Well, let's hope to see you here in the rest of the days that are left on the San Diego
when
Latino.
When is this going online, do you think?
I'm hoping that, I don't think tomorrow, but maybe
like
by the weekend, maybe by the weekend, Saturday at most.
By Saturday, yes. Well, Saturday you've got a bunch of great films to come see. And then Sunday, of course, short films.
Yeah.
So much more.
So see you around.